Okay, so Akhila, today we are going to start with the stuff with the Python first basics only, that what actually is object-oriented programming. We say Python is an object-oriented programming, but what actually does it mean? Why do we say so? Right. So what happens in here in Python is that every class, everything that we use, means be it a print statement or be it a addition of two numbers, anything that we are talking about, everything is bounded inside the classes. And to access those classes, what we have to do is we have to create a object of that so that we can access each and everything inside a class. Like over here, if I just create one more package over here and I'll show you package. And inside this, I hope you heard the point that you do not have to edit this file. This init file that gets automatically created, you don't have to edit this file. I hope you got that.
So ma'am, sorry. So I have one doubt. In every time, if I create new project, so I want to create that package. If understood what I told. Because every time if I want to create new project, like day one project is no. So
Just a second, this thing that I see. A second, there is some issue with the project structure. It is not showing the project. So this is the project that I have created. I have created it again, but I don't know why it's taking this place. Just a second. I changed it there. It should be here. So now I'll be creating one package over here. As soon as I click this name, as soon as I press enter, this package will be created. Along with this, there is an automatic file created. This file I'm talking about, this will help you to access the rest of the files that you're going to make inside this particular package, this day one package. So you don't have to edit that. If you'll edit this automatic file which is being created, it's going to actually ruin your particular project particular package, so you don't have to edit or delete this file. This double underscore init double underscore dot py. You don't have to do anything with this file. Okay, so be careful about that. These files I'm going to create. Now, as coming back to the topic that we were discussing, the object-oriented program. So I'll just will simply create a file, and over here, so over here, if I'll just say print, this print is actually a particular part of a particular class that we are using, but it's the root one, so we are not going to talk about this one. Let's make first, let's see how the class is defined, and then I'll tell you instead of going into the internal files. In Python, the class creation is easy. You just have to give the keyword class followed by the name of the class that you're going to give. Let's say I'm going to give it as demo class. That's it. Followed by a semicolon. The semicolon specifies that it is a class that you are going to create. Once you press enter, it will take a amount of space. Automatically, it will shift the margin to a tab space. Now, what this space means that whatever you're going to write after this will be considered the part of the class, be it a simple print statement. If I just write this as well, then also it is a part of the class. If I'll say my first class, right? As soon as I remove this space, now I'm out of the class. Whatever next I'm going to write, it will not be the part of the class. It will be a general code that I'll be writing on. And what next we will be doing is to access this class. I want to see that I have made the class. What's inside that? I want to use it. I want to print it, right? So if I just go on and look, and I generally run this part, I have not done nothing, but there is a print statement, so it should be printed, right? So if I run this class, I get it printed, right? Now, if I make any function inside this class, this is just a print statement. I'm now going to create a function inside. How to create a function inside that? That's the keyword we use, def, followed by the name of the function that I want to give. Let's say I want to give it as function one, followed by a pair of parentheses, the circular brackets, and the colon term itself. When I have created the function, an automatic keyword has came. That is the self keyword. Now, what the self keyword is? The self keyword is very useful when we have to use another functions inside the class. That self keyword is going to allow you to access the rest of the methods. I'll show you the usage of self as well, but before that, we need to understand one more concept and then we'll come to this. Right. Now, inside this, I'll again have a simple print statement stating first function. Right. Now, I'll save this and I'll rerun it. To rerun the output, rerun the method, we have different options available. So you can use any of them that you like. I'm going to use the shortcut that is Shift 10. So over here you can see nothing has been changed in the output console. My first statement is only being printed. If I run it from here as well, so same, I'm not getting anything else. I'm not able to get this particular result. Why is it so? Because this function that we have made, it is inside the class and the scope, and it is only visible inside this class. So I have to make some kind of linking or some kind of reference so that I can use this class and the function inside. It could be possible there are more functions also. We'll make that and we'll see that how they are going to be accessed. But let's see how we can access this function now. So as I said, we have to create a reference. This is a class. Whatever I do inside is only visible to this particular space. Outside this, it's not visible. I'll go back to the main margin. Now I'll try to access this function one. I'll go on and I'll look for this function. I have given the whole name, but nothing has been found. It gives me an error that you have to create a function to access it. It's not visible directly. So to use it, what we'll do is we'll make the object of this class demo class so that whatever is inside, I can access that. So I'll comment it for the time. Now, how to create the object? The object creation in Python is very simple. You just have to give the name of the class. Just like this, it's appearing in front, demo class. You just have to follow it by a pair of parentheses. That's it. Your object has been created over here. Nothing needs to be done except for this. Right. Now, after this, after making this object, I will be putting a dot, and whatever is inside this function, inside this class, that is going to be visible now. As we have seen, function one was not visible before. Now I'll press enter and you can see in upfront only, I'm getting the function name that I have created. That is function one, right? Like this. Now if I save this code and I rerun my file, I get the output of both the statements that I have written in the class. Likewise, we can make more functions. Let's say I make one or two more functions to see. Let it be function. Inside this, again, a print statement only I'm introducing. Like this, right? I have three functions now. So if I have to access any of these over here, I have created an object so that I can use these three, which are not visible directly. So if I just look for here that what options do I get inside this class? These three functions that I have made, I can use any function over here. Simply, I just have to choose the function name and the output will be given to them. If I save this and I run this, I get the output of the second function that is here. Right. Any doubts or any questions till now? Now, over here, if I have to use all of the three functions in the same row, suppose I have to use all the functions that I have moved. So what I'll do, I'll again make the object and I'll call the function I need to call in the series. Let's say I want to call all them in the particular series 1, 2, and 3. So I created object and I call these functions. Now over here, what is happening is by this every time, by this only part, every time a new object is being created. Every time I'm writing this, every time a new object is being created and I'm calling the function independently, I'll get the output. I'll get the output like this. But here is a problem. We have to manage this in a proper way. If I have this right now, there are simple print statements inside this function. Suppose I have some calculation being performed in the functions and I have to store the result. That what is the result of adding one integer to another integer? I have to store that result. So by this, the function will be called. But that result, I have stored that result, I want to access it again. I want to use it again somewhere else. But now I won't be able to do that. Why so? Because these are the hanging objects. They don't have any kind of reference through which I can access this again. They are hanging objects with every time new being created, but nowhere it's being stored. In the memory, it's taking space, but I cannot access it again from the memory because I don't have any linkage. So what we do is, this is object creation. This is fine. But now what we do is, to simplify it more, we create a variable, a normal variable we are going to take. Let's say a variable D, a normal string, a character D. And this to this D, what I will be saying that store the value of the object which is created, the address of that object. So over here, I'll just will create an object, demo class. Now this time what is happening is an object is created and I have a reference to it named D. D. Next time when I have to access the methods inside, I won't create the object again. I'll just will say D dot, all the functions will come in front, like it's coming right now. I'll call them again. I'll call all the functions again as I have done before, D dot function 3. Right. Now, what is the difference between these two, these one and these one? Over here, if I have something to store, I cannot retrieve it again. Plus, there are three different objects being created, which is taking more memory, more space it is taking. So it is not the right way to do it. So we don't proceed with this. If I have to call one only function, then it is fine. But when I have to access the same class again and again and again, then we make the object once and we point it to some of the reference. People get confused over here that this D is the object. This is not the object. This is just a variable which is holding the address of the object. Object is still here. I'm just accessing it through the reference. If any time I am storing something in this, some variable is being stored in this function, I can just simply say, okay, point, use the reference D, and call the function 1. It will give me the result symbol instead of creating a new object and then having a hanging object. Right. So this is the main difference that needs to be understood when we are doing the part with object-oriented programming. It's with all the languages which are object-oriented programming, be it Java, be it Python. This is something which we need to understand. I hope that these two have cleared the difference between what is an object and what is an object reference. Is it? If there is any doubt, do let me. You can ping me in the chat if it is.
So object reference would be like D, right?
Yes, yes. This will be the object reference. Object is still here. This is the reference which is storing the address in the memory which is being occupied by the object. Okay, so now this was the main thing that I needed to clarify before proceeding on. Now coming back to the class that we have created. Now over here you can see that when I have created the class, an automatic keyword was coming. I was not entering it. I was not typing self by myself from the keyboard. But whenever I've used the parenthesis symbol, this automatically came. What is it? How do we use it? So this is a particular keyword which will help you to access the variables, classes which you have made inside the class. Right. Suppose I have one more function. I have one more function over here, which is def function 4. Now inside this function, what I'm going to do is I'm going to access these three functions inside this function. Right. So how will I be able to do that? I can simply say function. But you can see that by typing function or starting with FUC anything, there's nothing coming up. How will I be able to access it? Access the rest of the function. So I'll type self dot. Now all the functions are coming. We have to access the functions inside any function. This self is going to help. So I'll call function one over here. Then I can call the another function. The third function as well. Even if I have some variable over here in this class. Let's say I have a variable a is equals to 10. There is a variable which is storing the value 10 inside. I want to get it printed as well. So using the self keyword, I can do that also. I can say self dot. You can see that variable is coming a. I can access this as well. I can print it. I can simply say print. A or some action I want to perform, so that also I can do. A is also holding the value 10, so I'll increment it by 5. I'll say self.a plus 5. So some action also I can take direct. Instead of calling all these functions, I'll call one only function that is calling every function. I'll say function 4. That's it. I'll save this and I'll rerun this. This time you can see in the output, I'm getting the result of all the functions that I have made so far. And along with that, I'm also getting the access to the variable that I've made. And there is some operation also being performed. So this is the use of the self keyword. That is the importance of it. Okay, clear with the self keyword? You don't have to write it. It's automatically going to populate where it is necessary. So you don't have to take the headache of that. Now, along with this, in the class, there is something, one more, which is important at times, but that is optional. That is not something that you always have to make, but it is optional. And that is the constructor. What is the constructor? Constructor is basically a function, a private function, you can say. In Python, it is private. You cannot just directly access it. That is not allowed. Nor by self keyword, you won't be able to access it directly. But yes, in that particular constructor or the function, you can initialize a few things. You can just assign some values. All those things which you require throughout the class, that you can do. And how that constructor looks, it's simple. It's always initiated as a function itself. So def will be the keyword to start with it. And the constructor name is the same, always the same. That is double underscore init double underscore. That is the constructor. Self automatically came. Now what you have to do? Let's say I want to assign this A inside. I want to do this. I know by this I can access it. I can, using the self keyword, I can access it. Right. But suppose if I just do this, I simply run this without changing anything in my function. I just change the location of my variable. And if I run this now, what do I get? An exception. Demo class has no object A. It's saying this to me, that there is no particular variable named A over here. So how will be able to access the variable in here? This is a private function. As I said, it's a private function. You won't be able to directly access it. Right. So that's why I got an error. Now, how to resume it? So instead of directly giving the variable, we use the self keyword. Using the self keyword, I'll say self.a is equals to 10. Right. Now, I have the keyword self. I know how that self is going to help. That helps me to access the variables and functions inside. I made a variable, and that is right. Now, if I run this, will I be able to access that variable? So I'll save this and I'll run this once again. I got the out. So anything inside this is not directly accessible. You have to access it using the self keyword. Be it anything. This is a variable. You can also initialize a string which you need throughout the class or anything like that. Now these are of two types. This is the default one. The default constructor. Now, what does we mean by default constructor is that it does not take any of the parameter. It does not accept anything except the self. Right. And there is one more type of constructor that we can use, and that is the parameterized one. What that does, what is the difference between both is that it can accept a parameter. It can accept some arguments from the user. Maybe you are adding some variables. And you have to dynamically take it from the user that every time that function is running, new input can be come. So how that is initialized? The same way. Constructor is always the same. You never have to change the name. Just what you have to do is in here with the self, the argument will come which you want to give. Let's say I want to give the variable A itself. I will be passing, every time I will be calling this class, I will be passing a variable value, whatever I want, I will be passing that. And to access it throughout the class, I need to do self.a, the variable locally to access the passed value. This time, I won't be hard coding it. Whatever the user will pass, that I'll give. So I'll say A. This A will be storing the value whichever user will be passed. Right. Now over here, by this constructor, there is going to be a little change in the object creation. How? Let's say, let's use it like this only and see what we get. I save this. And I run this. So over here, what do I get is an exception. And what does it say? That this function or the constructor is missing with an argument. There is to be passed an argument. A variable has to be passed, but that is not being passed. And where am I getting it? At line number 31. What is line number 31? Let's see. This is line number 31, the object creation. So over here, how is it connected? Whenever we make a constructor, whenever we make an object, at that time, the interpreter, the Python language that we are using, always checks over here in the pair of parentheses that is something being passed. There is nothing passed initially, right? We were not using the constructor initially, so we did not pass anything. So it understands by that there is a constructor, a default constructor, which does not need anything to be passed, which is this one. So it was running. Now this time it says that, okay, nothing is being passed. Let's go inside the class and see what is inside. So very first thing inside the class is a constructor, which is asking for a parameter A, which we haven't passed. So it asks you to give something so that it can access this particular part and move further to the function that you have. Okay, so parameterized constructor, if you are making inside the class, the object will acquire the parameters that you are passing. So this time, in the object creation, I'll pass the variable 100. Okay, a parameter, a value has been passed. So this value from here will go inside this constructor over here. This A is now holding 100. So let's see what output do we get. I save this and I run this. So this time, what do I get is no errors we have got. We got our statements printed over here. And over here, when we are operating the A variable with the increment of 5, I get 105. So this way, the constructors perform an important role. As I mentioned earlier, they are not compulsory. If you don't want to give them, that's perfectly okay. Your code will not be blocked. You just have to make sure that the object is created perfect, like this. Now, this is going to give me an error because we don't have any constructor. So I'll comment this. And now if I run this, it is going to run simple, like this. So this is how you use a constructor. Clear with the constructor part and how it is used, the self keyword. Any question, any doubts over here?
Why this constructive is called the private?
Because you cannot directly access it. The functions that we have made before, there were no symbols ahead, right? But over here, these symbols that we have attached, they have prefixed double underscore. They have restricted that you cannot directly change any value inside. If something has been kept inside it, that is the standard, the strict rule for the class. I have given the value A. I don't want anyone to change the value of A anytime inside the class. I want it to be 100 initially and keep it 100 throughout I'm working with it. So it restricts the user not to change the value anytime without the permission.
Okay.
That's why it's not directly accessible as well.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yeah. Any another from Shri?
Yes.
Yeah. Do you have any questions? Seems like no, so I'll move further. So this was the main thing that I wanted you to understand in the OOPS concept, that how actually the things work and why there are the restrictions. So I won't be taking it more ahead. These are the simple ones. If you want to learn it more briefly, more exaggerated, then you can just go through the videos once and look for that. Proper examples and everything is being given with a proper detail, so you can go through that as well. Okay, now taking the course to the Selenium part, this was enough for the Python part. Now I'll move on with the Selenium. Yesterday we have completed that how we can actually use the Selenium and we can check what the version is. Now we are going to start with the automation process. In the automation process, when we are automating some browser, what is the first thing that you think will be the first part, the initial part? What is the first? Anyone can tell me this.
What was the question? Sorry.
When we are going to start with the automation of a browser, what is the first step that we start with?
Going to the website.
That's almost correct. But by starting a browser, by opening a browser.
Yeah, browser.
Right. We are going to dynamically inform that which browser I'm going to start with. Maybe I'm today using Chrome. Tomorrow I want to do it with Edge or Firefox. So I have to tell that. According to that only, my code will understand and open the specific browser. So that is the first thing, right? So how to do that? Let's just see that. before that, I just want to add that Selenium in my project. I've created the new project, so it will not be here. So I'll just go over here, Python interpreter, add. So now, to understand that, let's just visit the website along and see what the website has to say for us. So I'll open the official website, that is selenium.dbb, downloads. With Python and the API docs. In the API docs, you are going to get each and everything about each and every class that we are going to access ahead, each and every process that we are going to learn, be it opening a browser or to inspecting a particular element on the website. Everything is available in this particular link. Just have to go and check it out if you want. You can simply go and see. Okay, now we have seen how to get the Selenium into our system. Now we have to move on with the opening of a browser. So over here in the example one, if you can see, it's telling you that you have to import Selenium. Selenium, what Selenium is? It's a class. It's basically a package that has been made, and inside the packages, there are classes that are made and we have to access. So to access any class, what do we need to do? We have to make the object, that too, not a hanging object, but a reference to it so that I can use it again and again throughout the class, throughout the file. So I'll just will come up over here and I'll import a class over here from the Selenium package. I'll import this WebDriver class that I need to do first. Okay. Now, I'll create a reference for this class WebDriver. I'll create an object and provide a reference to it simply. So I'll say, let's say driver is equals to WebDriver. Okay. Now after that, directly also you can access it. So over here, directly we are taking this variable driver. We will be accessed so on and so on. Now, in this WebDriver dot, when I press dot, everything inside this class is going to be visible to me, right? So if we see, what do we get? I get the first browser name, that is IE, Internet Explorer. If we move further, then I get the package of Opera as well. Just with the suggestion box, you can see over here, it's written that what IE is, it's a variable. Then second IE, that is a package that's showing the folder icon, that is a package. Then this action change, C, that is a class. Like that, you can identify that whatever you are going to next use is, what's the thing, right? So we have to open a browser. Let's see what we get. Whichever browser I want to open, let's say I want to open Chrome. I want to open Chrome browser, followed by a parenthesis. This is the only command to open a browser. If I save this and I run this class, it's going to take the process in and open the browser for me. You can see a blank Chrome browser has been opened over here. Simple. But in your case, it might not work. Why? Because to access this only command, you need to have the driver of the particular browser that you're going to use. If you're using Chrome, then Chrome has a particular driver class, browser provider. You need to have that in your system. So from where to get those driver classes, you have to download them. They are the zip packages basically. You have to download them and keep it in a system. No need to run them. Initially, I'm telling you. Now coming to from where you will get it. Chrome. We opened Chrome browser, right? So over on this link only, as I said, you'll get each and everything. So the browser, the drivers also will be available here. The links will be available and you can download it from here. So for Chrome, you can see over here, the driver section, the links are given over here for particular browsers. For Edge, Firefox, and Chrome, it is given. So if I'll just go to this link, I get the details of all the Chrome releases so far. As many as versions of Chrome has been launched so far, they are all listed over here. What you need to do is you need to know what version of Chrome you are using, that you can check from this three options, help, and then about Chrome, about Google Chrome. And here the version will be mentioned, that this is the version of Chrome that you are using in your system. Mine is 92.0.4515. That is the version. So from here, from this link, I'll download that only version. You can see this second one shows me the version that I have just checked from my Chrome. So I'll just will click on this. I click on this and here I get these zip file options. According to your system configuration, if you have Linux, Mac, Windows, 32 or 64 bit, according to that, you have to download the particular file from here. So this is for Mac, this is for Mac, this is for Linux, this is for Windows. So we'll just click on this and a zip file will be downloaded into your system. Just have to extract the file. Here is the executable file. I'll show you. This way you are going to get the this zip file. You just have to extract this package and you will get one file out of it. So what I have done is I have made a package in my C drive, a folder in my C drive named web drivers only. And whatever I get the file after extraction from the zip file, I have kept it over here. Simple, you have to just do it. You don't have to run anything out of it. Just keep the files over. Okay. The same way in case of Edge, or we'll come to Edge in some time. Let's just see. Once we have the driver, then how you have to execute it. So over here, what you have to do is what this command says. So over here, it tells you this, that it is the browser part. No, you don't have to go to this. Instead, you just will come up over here in the parentheses. Now, if you pass something, what you will be passing is that this is a variable executable path. The constructor of this class requires this thing. It is not compulsory. If you don't pass anything, then also it works. If you pass, then also it works. So you have to see which is your conversion path. So in the executable path, what do you have to do? You have to give the path of the file that you have just extracted and keep it here. So in my case, this is the thing. This is my path. Dash, the name of the driver that you are looking for. We are opening Chrome, so I'll open up the Chrome driver. So over here, I'll complete this Chrome driver. It automatically gives you the name. You can see. You just have to press enter and that's it. This will also work. I'll save this. I'll rerun this. This time also, it's going to open the blank Chrome browser for me. And my code has been executed. Okay. Any questions so far that how to opening in this part?
No, I'm good.
Okay. Now the same way, the command is going to be the same for the rest of the browsers. Just the name of the browser is going to change. If you have to open the web browser, the browser Firefox or the Edge. So what you'll do is again, driver is equals to webdriver.edge. We'll complete this Edge. this will work in my case. I'll tell you the solution that how this is going to work as well. But initially, you need to have the drivers. So for edge, in here on this page, you'll get the driver. You'll get this link. Open this link up. Same way we have downloaded the Chrome driver, we have to do the same thing over here as well. You have to look for the version of Edge you are using in your system. And from here, you will get all the links. Right now, it says only one stable version for Edge. That is this one. So according to your system configuration, you have to get it downloaded. This is for Windows 32, Windows 64, Mac, and Linux. So according to that, download it. A zip file will be given to you. Extract it. And keep it at the same location where you have kept the Chrome drive, like this. Have to open up Edge. Again, what you have to do is executable path. Give the location of your driver, that is MS. It gives the name. Save it. I'm going to comment the Chrome command because it will open two browsers. I'll save this and I'll run this. This time it will open up the Edge browser like this. For Firefox also, you have to do the same thing. Driver equals to webdriver dot Firefox. And for the Firefox also, you need to get the executable path, the driver you need to get. So for that, again, go to the same link. And for Firefox, this is the one given over here. So over here, for Firefox, you don't have to be specific about the versions. You can just come to this link over here, and the zip files are given directly for the Firefox browser. You don't have to worry about the specific version. But yes, there is one thing that you have to be careful in Firefox, that browsers usually don't ask before the update. Once the new version is coming, it automatically gets it updated. But over here in Firefox, what they do is the browser providers don't immediately give you the drivers of the recent versions. It is a little older. So what you have to be careful about Firefox is that you don't have to let it update automatically. Whenever the version update comes, you don't have to automatically update it. So what you need to do is, you just need to open up your your browser over here, Firefox, and you have to stop the automatic update. So for that, you need to just go over to these options and then settings. And in here in the settings, you will get a section of update. Downloads digital, over here. This is just general. You can see over here that right now the default option that is selected is automatically install updates. You don't have to do that, because if any time a latest update comes and the driver does not support that change, your code might get hung. So that you have to be careful. You just have to choose the another option, that check for updates, that whether they are available or not. But you choose it when you are ready for that. You need to wait for some time, and after that you update the browser. That is one thing about Firefox that you have to be careful about. Rest is all okay. Just look for the appropriate configuration from here for the zip file for Linux, Windows, and Mac, and get the zip file. Extract the zip file and keep it at the same locations where your earlier two browsers are linked. Over here, Firefox browser has the driver given as the Kiko driver. They have named it like that. So you'll get the zip executable file for that. And here in the command, you have to give the path. /, drive. I'll save this and I'll run this. Firefox browser has one more small issue that when you fire this command to open the browser, it takes a while. For a few seconds it takes as compared to Chrome and Edge, but later on it works absolutely fine. You can see over here a blank Firefox browser has been opened and my code has been completed. Okay, this is the way you can open up any browser that you want. I'm not going into the Internet Explorer because that has been deprecated. That's not in the use currently, so we are not going to discuss this. We're going to talk about these three only for the time. Now, this path, I don't want to give this path every time I want to open some browser because it will be a tedious work. If I want to open it, I want to change it every day. So this will be a tedious work. So what the solution for this could be that instead of giving the path over here, you just simply add this folder where you have kept all the drivers. You add this folder in your system variables. That's what you need to do. How to add it? Just go on. Yes, if you are in the need of accessing all the browsers, then you have to download the drivers for all. When you have to add this folder in the system variables, you just simply go to your environment variables. Over here, inside the system variables, where you have to add it is in the path variable. Edit this and add the folder name like I have done over here. That folder name is here. By this, what will happen is anytime you add a new driver or you update a new driver, you don't have to manually edit it in your code. From this folder, from your system variables, it's automatically going to apply on your code as well. So that is a thing that you can do. After adding the folder, click OK to all the three OKs that has been given and done. There's one thing that might be just after adding the folder, your code does not work as it was working in my case by not giving this. This might not work exactly. So what you need to do is you just need to restart your system once so that the changes that you have done gets applied. That you have to do. And once you restart your system and run this code again, your code will be running as it is running for me right now without passing the path. Okay. Questions, any doubts?
I'm good.
Okay. I expect Akila, you are also good with the topics. Okay, so it seems okay with both of you. So I will be closing the class by these topics today. I expect you guys to practice this, the OOPS concept, and for more clarity, you can practice it by your hand so that you can understand what errors takes when you start working with it. And initiate the browsers by giving the commands, including the driver path and not giving the driver path, and see how both the ranges are different from each other. Okay, if you face any issue, do let me know in the next class. We'll solve it. Okay,
actually, I have one quick question. Like, when we set up in the new project, there is an interpreter. Do we need to see anything in the interpreter? Because I'm not seeing anything on the interpreter. Do we need to see? I forgot what is that interpreter. Like you mentioned in yesterday's class, no? Something I'm asking.
Oh, interpreter, you are going to initially set in the starting. When you're creating the project, at that time, the interpreter will be set. Because initially when you are installing the Python in your system, you add it in the system variables, right? I mentioned that. So from that only, the project picks up the interpreter itself. If there is some error, the interpreter will give you an error straight away without any issue. Since it interprets line by line, so it will give you the line number as well. Just for the different files, different configurations will be made, but the interpreter will be same for the whole project.
Okay. Because like on the interpreter drop down, I don't see anything. Like when I'm setting up the project.
Mm-hmm. Initially, there was really nothing. Initially, when you have made no class, you have not run the project anytime. Initially, there will be nothing. Just add configuration would be mentioned over here. I hope you get that over here. Add
I got that. Yes. Yeah.
So once you run any file, the configuration will be created for that. And then you will see the name of that particular file, that this is the file and this is the configuration. And as soon as you keep running the files and files, a list will be given to you that these all are the configurations that you have run so far.
Okay.
Any other doubt or questions?